I greet you all in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'd like to thank God for this opportunity to share the word with you once again. Let us open our Bibles in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 11. First Samuel chapter 11, verse 14 to 15. And also open 1 Samuel 13, chapter 13. Hold 1 Samuel chapter 13 as well. But let's start with 1 Samuel 11. Samuel said to the people, "Come, let us go to Gilgal and there restore the kingdom." So all the people went to Gilgal, and there they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. There they also sacrificed peace offerings before the Lord, and there Saul and all the men of Israel rejoiced greatly. Let's go to 13. 1 Samuel 13, verse 8. It reads, "Now Saul waited 7 days according to the appointed time which Samuel had set. But Samuel had not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattering away from Saul. So Saul said, 'Bring me the burnt offering and peace offerings.' And he offered the burnt offering, which he was forbidden to do. As soon as he finished offering the burnt offering, Samuel finally came. Saul went out to meet him and welcome him, but Samuel said, 'What have you done?' Saul said, 'Since I saw that the people were scattering away from me, and that you did not come within the appointed time, and that the Philistines were assembling at Michmash, therefore I said, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not asked for the Lord's favor by making supplication to him. So I forced myself to offer the burnt offering.' Samuel said to Saul, 'You have acted foolishly. You have not kept the commandments of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For if you had obeyed, the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever.'" Hallelujah. Let us bow our heads and we pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this opportunity to be in your house to hear your word. Father, we ask that let this word be a seed that will bring glory to your holy name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Here we are reading about King Saul. In chapter 13, in the beginning of the chapter, the Bible said Saul had only become king for 2 years. That's what verse 1 said. And at the beginning of the story, we had chapter 11, which explained how they got to Gilgal. It was after they have conquered that Saul, the prophet, said to Israel, "Go to Gilgal so that we can establish the kingdom once we are in Gilgal." By what? By burnt offerings. Hallelujah. The Bible says people went to Gilgal, and when they got there, chapter 13 says, when Saul saw that he had conquered, he only assigned for himself 3,000 army men, and he released the rest to go to their houses. Where we are reading, it's after Saul and Jonathan went and forged war against the Philistines. And the Bible says, when the Philistine heard that Jonathan has attacked one of their camps, they grouped or called about 33,000 men for the army. And remember, the Israel, Saul only had 3,000. But Saul forgot that as for them to be in Gilgal, there was a command: go to Gilgal and wait for 7 days. Then when I come, we will make an offering to establish your kingdom. In other words, Saul's kingdom was not yet established before Samuel could make the sacrifice at Gilgal. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor and say, "Learn to wait." Tell them again, "Learn to wait." Saul here, all he had to do was to wait for Prophet Samuel to come. And the Bible says his kingdom would have been established forever. But because of the impatience and the circumstances that he didn't see, or the circumstances that rather he put himself into, he had to go against the command that he was given to wait, and went ahead and make the sacrifice. And when he made the sacrifice, his reason was he saw that people are now running away from him. Why? Because when the Philistine heard that Jonathan had struck one of their camps, they ganged up and they were ready to go for Israel. Knowing that his army men are fewer than the Philistines, he thought, if I can make the sacrifice and inquire of the Lord, eventually I will conquer the Philistines. But he forget a simple instruction: go and wait for 7 days in Gilgal. And him failing to wait a few more minutes on the seventh day costed him his entire kingdom, costed him his entire blessing, costed him the promise that God has given him, which was, your reign is going to be great. That day that Saul made an offering, it was the day that God rejected him, because he failed to wait for the prophet. Now there are some things that happen as a Christian in your life that you feel, I have been waiting long enough. I have done all that I'm supposed to do, but the answer is not coming. I am here to tell you, keep on waiting. The answer is around the corner. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are some things that when you do, or when you are doing them, you feel, I have been in this state long enough. I have been in this situation long enough. I have been doing what I've been doing. I have been waiting long enough. And we forget, what exactly does it mean to wait? To wait is simply to stand by, having a certain attitude towards what you are waiting for. The problem is, in the midst of waiting, we now start, like Saul, forging things that we think that will help us in our situation. We start doing things that we think we are helping God to help us. We start doing things that will, at the end of the day, we will say, Mudimu tushabai tushang. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Instead of us to sit and say, I will wait for the establishment of the promise, I will wait for the fulfillment of the prophecy, I will wait for the fulfillment of the promise that God has given me, we tend to do things that make us to be rejected by God, whereas we are thinking we are doing ourselves a favor. Tell your neighbor and say, learn to wait. Had Saul waited a few more minutes, it was already on the seventh day. The Bible says Samuel had not yet come. Although people were leaving Saul, Saul could have understood, as long as the prophet is not here, there is nothing that I can do. I need to wait. Why? Because greater is the promise I have than the sacrifice which has to be made. His promise was, he's going to rule Israel and be a victorious king over Israel. Why? Because Saul was the king that people of Israel cried unto God for a leader. And God provided Saul. And when Saul was provided, everything that Samuel said, when you turn away from me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will happen. You will prophesy. You will meet people who will give you bread. This and that will happen. The Bible says it happened as the prophet said. But on the last day, he couldn't wait a few more minutes, a few more seconds, one more step for his kingdom to be established. Well, you can say to yourself, well, I've been waiting.
But the question is, while you are waiting upon, are you waiting with the right kind of attitude? Are you waiting with the mindset that you know that even as I am waiting and others are passing or others are living, I know when the good Lord finally arrives, my own story will be changed, my own life will be transformed. Are you waiting with an understanding that as I wait and as others are accelerating, I am not wasting time? Are you waiting with an understanding that as I wait, even if the Philistines were to invade us, I'm still the chosen king over Israel? Therefore, as long as the prophet has not arrived, it means the Philistines cannot overpower us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As you read chapter 13 going down, the Bible says, Saul, after all this, after Samuel said to him, you have acted foolishly. God has now rejected you because of what you've done. The Bible says the next morning he woke up, he was only left with 600 soldiers. He was no longer left with the 3,000. He was left with 600 soldiers. Now, what are 600 soldiers compared to thousands of the Philistines? The war was already finished. Am I right? Am I right? The war was already finished in the carnal eye. In the reality of things, the war was finished. Because how do you conquer 1,000 with 600 people? It's not possible. The same things apply to your life, that there are things that we do as children of God that cause us the blessings that God has given us because we are failing to wait. There are things that the enemy whispers in our ears and we make them a normality and we start comparing each other, we start rating each other, we start rating how far, who has gone and what has done and what I have achieved. You start rating yourself by the surrounding around you, whereas all you have to do is to wait upon the Lord with the right kind of an attitude, knowing that when you are waiting, He is He alone who renews your strength. Today we are Christians that are in the kingdom, that are ineffective. Because each and every day of our lives, we derive ways and things of going about the kingdom. And we don't want to go about the kingdom way. We want to go about the kingdom, the statistic way. We want to go about the kingdom the way people think the kingdom should be, not how God wants the kingdom to be. How many of us today are inside the cul-de-sac because of situations we caused ourselves? Because we could not wait on the Lord. Some of us, we are sick. We don't have help. There's nothing the doctors can do. Why? Because we failed to wait on the Lord. Some of us, we are in debt. Why? Because we failed to wait upon the Lord. Isaiah says, they that wait upon the Lord, He does what? He renews their strength. The question is, why are you renewing your own strength? Yes, God says, I will bless the works of your hand, because you will say, I am doing what I'm doing because I have to work. God says He will bless the works of my hands. Yes, He will bless the works of your hands while you are waiting. What is not to wait is to go out of your way to get what you want. That is not waiting. Putting that envelope underneath the door for you to get that contract, to get that job, that is not waiting. Forgetting that the Bible says all promises are yes and in Christ are amen. That is not waiting. Because the minute you come up with ways or strategies that will help you to attain what you want, you are no longer waiting. You have already made the sacrifice. And when you have already made the sacrifice, you have already lost the promise. The Bible says, with long life will I satisfy you. You will only be above and never beneath. You will be blessed going in and blessed going out. You will be blessed in the city. You will be blessed in the country. Today we are not blessed anymore. Why? Because we have sought out ways that look conducive for ourselves so that we can get out of the situation that God has placed us in. When Saul, Samuel said to Saul, go wait for me in Gilgal. He was aware there are Philistines camping, lying in ambush for the Israel. He was aware of that situation. But he said, go and wait for me in Gilgal until I come, so that we can make the offering and the sacrifice to establish your kingdom. But because Saul was a man with a lot of ambition, like you and me today, thought, only if I can make this sacrifice and acquire of the Lord and go against these Philistines, I know we will conquer them. And at the end of the day, when we conquer them, the great name comes to me. Now you are no longer only not waiting, you also have pride. Because now you are seeking a solution that brings glory to you and not to God. Why? Because we failed to wait. In the same chapter 13, from verse 14, Samuel said, after he said this, that God has rejected you, is the same Samuel who said to Saul, God has now sought a man after his own heart. Now look at this. It means God knew already that Saul is going to sacrifice in Gilgal. And in the meantime, he prepared himself a man who's called David, a man after the heart of God, who will now lead and inherit Israel instead of Saul. Meaning when God gives you a situation, he knows the outcome of it. He knows what's going to happen on the other side. He knows what you're going to meet on the road. All you have to do is to sit and wait. The Bible says in Psalms that wait patiently, quietly. How many of us can still say we are waiting where God said we should wait? We are Christians. We are coming to church each and every day. We call ourselves born again. But are we still in the same spot that God said, wait for me? We still come into church, but by our hearts, you can wonder, you can be asking yourself, but I'm coming to church. Yes, you are coming to church, but your heart has moved from the promise that God has given you. That's why we have Christians that nothing is happening. That's why we have Christians that are prayed for the same thing over and over and over again. That's why there is that challenge in front of you that you are failing to defeat. That challenge in front of you that you are failing to overcome. Why? Because our hearts are no longer waiting. We have already moved from the promise that God has given us. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, there are situations that when they happen, they look like they are not moving. They look like you are not going anywhere. But when God has placed you in a wait season, in a place and say, wait here for me. Do my will here for me. Let's sit there and wait, because greater is the promise than what we are seeing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us not allow ourselves to be fooled by the people who are leaving us. Don't you always say the people who leave you are not meant to be in your life? In your waiting season is the season of God to cultivate you, to turn you, to take out the things that are not supposed to be. To make the way straight for you so that when you get up and you go into the promise, the promise will be everlasting. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I love a scripture that says, the promises of the Lord maketh rich, and they add no sorrow with it. But how many of us are dining and whining and sleeping with sorrow because we couldn't just wait for the Lord? Some of us are praying unnecessary prayers because of a self-injury. Self-afflicted injury. So many of us are in cul-de-sac. We are still in the same situation, in the same valley. We are not moving. Why? Because when God came and wanted to take you where he placed you, he couldn't find you. We had already moved. By our talkings, by our doings, by our sayings, by things we do behind doors that nobody can see. Remember Adam and Eve? God says to them, eat every fruit of the field except the tree in the middle of the garden. Because it is the tree of life. The devil came and said, and whispered to Eve, and said, no, it's because God knows that if you eat it, you are going to be wise. If you eat it, you will know good and evil. You'll be wiser than him. Out of curiosity, Eve destroyed the entire generation. The Bible says, then snake gave her the apple and she took a bite. The Bible says she felt that it was good. And she said to herself, I'm going to give my husband Adam so that he can eat. Now look at this. It was Adam who was given the instruction, do not eat the tree in the middle of the garden. The Bible says when Adam took a bite, immediately he noticed he was naked. And noticing that he was naked, the Bible says they went and hid themselves. Now as they are hiding themselves, they are walking away from the presence of the Lord. They are walking away from the promise of God that you must rule the earth, subdue it, control it, have dominion over it. You are kings and queens of this field, of this garden of Eden. They were walking away from the promise and they realized they are naked and they started needing leaves to make clothes for themselves. See, when God came for them, when he said, Adam, Adam, where are you? It means God went to the same spot. He knows this is where they are always. This is where they stay. This is where they are found. And when God there, when God finally went there, when he got there, there was no one. That's why he had to call, Adam, Adam, where are you? The same thing, we are in Charis Missionary Church. There is that promise that God gave you the first day you entered through that door. But because of talkings and stories and things of life and people whispering things that they don't exist into your ear, the devil using that, you have moved away from the promise. Now when God finally comes with that promise that you have been waiting for, that desire you have been praying for, he can't find you where he left you. Why? Because we failed to wait. We failed to wait. Tell your neighbor and say, learn to wait. Only if Adam and Eve said to the serpent, God said, we should not eat. There are many fruits all over this garden, but we should never eat of the one in of the tree in the midst of the garden. There would still be an Eden for all of us today. If only they had not eaten the fruit, we wouldn't be giving birth to children through pain. We wouldn't be having to work and eat the sweat of our forehead for us to live. We wouldn't have to till the ground for us, for it to yield out fruits that will sustain us and our children. But because we couldn't wait, we couldn't stay in a place where God has placed us. When he comes, he cannot find us. We are now into cul-de-sac. And now we are praying unnecessary prayers. Now we are doing things that we are not supposed to do. Now we have bound ourselves to things that we cannot disconnect ourselves with anymore. Why? Because we only failed to wait. Just a few more minutes. That's all Saul needed. Because the Bible says, the minute he finished burning the sacrifice, Samuel entered. Meaning, by the time the sacrifice was on the altar about to be lit, Samuel was somewhere around close by. By the time you think, no, let me go out and do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the Lord is right by the corner, holding the blessing you've been so much waiting for. But because we couldn't wait a few more minutes, we couldn't wait a little more time, we have costed ourselves generations. Remember, we are not only saved for ourselves, but we are saved for generations to come. Your generation is supposed to know Christ through you. Generation, your family, is supposed to know Christ through you. But because we failed to wait on the Lord, we are where we are today. Ask your neighbor and say, have you waited? Or are you waiting? Ask your neighbor again, are you waiting? Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor to answer you and be honest. Are you waiting? Daddy was preaching about honesty last week, Sunday. Are you waiting on the Lord? Not waiting, finding a way out. Are you waiting on the Lord? Most of us, we have entered into wrong contracts. We have entered into wrong marriages. We have entered into wrong relationships. We have entered into wrong businesses. We have entered into wrong companies because we are only failing to wait. What happened to Christians who used to come and acquire of the Lord and they are given instructions and they go and follow the instruction to the T? These days, if you get a business, you look at which one gives you more money than the other one. We no longer come to acquire of the Lord. Lord, as I wait, what should I do? And after you are told to go and wait, do you wait? Ask yourself, do you really wait? We have young men and young women today, we have entered the gospel wrongfully, not through the gate. Why? Because they are failing to wait. Whatever looks like it has life, it's making money for others, you are found there. Whatever looks like it's going right for other people, you even gave it a name that I am hustling. But there's no part of the Bible that says you shall be a hustler. The Bible says you shall be called blessed. You shall be called what? How many people are calling you blessed? Just because we are failing to wait. And now because the devil has seen that we grow so impatient with God, he even introduced things of bringing certain things in life and make them normal. Now we are making babies out of machines because we are failing to wait. Now we are cutting and joining cars because we are failing to wait. Now we are buying our way out or buying our way in into an institution because we are failing to wait. Hallelujah. Me and you, we are like Saul today. The question is, are we going to wait for Samuel to arrive or not? Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's read Acts chapter 1, verse 4. Can I read for you? 4 to 8, Acts 1, it reads, while being together and eating with them, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for
for what the Father had promised, of which he said, you have heard me speak. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized and empowered and united with the Holy Spirit not long from now. So when they had come together, they asked him repeatedly, Lord, are you at this time reestablishing the kingdom and restoring it to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power and ability when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses to all people about me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and even to the ends of the earth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here Jesus was with his disciples. He was telling him, after the crucifixion, stay in Jerusalem. Do not leave. Stay there and wait for what the Father has promised, which is what? The Holy Spirit. As mortal people like you and me, they are asking, is this the time for you to reestablish the kingdom and bring it back to Israel? Is this the time where you get to give me my contract and I get to drive my big car? Is this the time where you are blessing me with marriage and I get to move into a big house? Is this the time where you are blessing me with millions and I get to be a kingdom financier? Did you hear what Jesus said in verse 7? He said, it is not for you to know the times and the seasons. It is not for you to know the times and the seasons which the Father has set aside himself. But this is the promise. You will receive the Holy Spirit. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. That was the promise. Or when will the Holy Spirit comes? Even Jesus didn't know. Only the Father knew. Meaning, they just had to sit in Jerusalem. No matter how long it took, they had to sit in Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit so that they can now be witnesses all over. Now imagine, the Bible says, so that you can be witnesses in Samaria, in all Judea, until the end of the age, until we, in this time, 2024, we are receiving the gospel. If they had not waited, would we have the gospel today? No. Why? Because they would not have been empowered by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, they cannot become witnesses. You see that when you get out of the promise, you don't become what you are supposed to be. You become a shadow of yourself. And unfortunately, the enemy is able to whisper in our ear and convince us that you are what God said you will be. The truth is, let's be honest with ourselves. Are we what God said we will be? Are we truly living in the purpose of the Lord? How many of us can stand up and say, I am living in what God said I am created for. I am doing what God said I'm supposed to be doing. How many of us can say that here today? I am living in the promise that God promised. I am walking in the path that God said I will walk. I have sat and I have waited. And I was imparted, I received power when the Holy Spirit came upon me. We are Christians, yes, who are moving around without the Holy Spirit because we couldn't wait for him. We are immaturely born into what we are supposed to be born into because we failed to wait. And we wonder why, like other children, why are we not living in the promise? It's because we are premature. Because we couldn't wait. Take an example of a woman who's pregnant and you give birth prematurely because of uncontrolled circumstances. I'm not saying you cause you are the cause of your premature birth. No. I'm saying, imagine a woman, you are pregnant and you give birth to a child prematurely because of certain circumstances. That's what doctor says, isn't it? Because of unseen situations, you have gone into labor. Let's take that scenario and place yourself, me and you, as that child in the womb, waiting for the 9 months so that we can come out into the world and do what we are supposed to do. And when we are there as an embryo, as in the womb of the Lord, we decide 9 months is too long. I've been here long enough. 7 months is good. It will do. And we find a way of going out. We splash out the water. The washer gushes out. We are supposed to be born prematurely. What is going to happen to us? A premature baby has to be put in the incubator. You know why? Because certain lungs, livers, certain organs are not fully developed. So that's why they incubate you, so that your inner parts, organs, can fully develop. Now imagine, as a child of God, you went out of the promise prematurely. Your organs are not fully developed. You don't have discerning, you don't have censoring, you don't hear, you don't talk, you can't walk. And you want to go in the world and manifest the kingdom. Is that even possible? The Bible says 1,000 years is like a day to the Lord. You can be saying, I have been here for 10 years in charities. It's just that you don't know. I've been cleaning these chairs for 10 years. I've been sweeping these floors for, I have been doing this, I've been doing that for 10 years, and I am still in the same spot. Ask yourself, are you still in the same spot that God has left you or God has put you? Are you still in the same place that God said, sweep the floor? Are you still sweeping the floor with all your heart, or you are sweeping the floor because it's something you have to do and your heart has already gone away from sweeping? There are some of us, we are here today in the church, we are holding our Bibles, writing notes, but our minds and our hearts are somewhere else. Some of you are in meetings, some of you are cooking dinner, some of you are ironing, some of you are cleaning, some of you are doing this, you are doing that. But your body is in the church. Same applies with waiting. As you are serving God, are you still waiting on Him? Or you are serving God because it's a duty that you must do? You are now coming to church because it's a duty. Well, I'm a Christian, I can't stay without coming to church. The Bible says when the disciples have remained in Jerusalem, when the Holy Spirit came upon them, they started speaking in an unknown tongue. They started speaking in a language that they couldn't understand themselves. The Bible says even people who heard, they came out to ask a question. What is God? Why are these people speaking in our languages? Whereas they don't know these languages, what is happening? They even thought that the disciples were drunk. And Paul answered, it's still early in the morning to take sweet wine. Why? Because they waited. Some of you have been promised that you will be the star of your family. You'll be a wonder of your family. And you are asking yourself, how come I'm not becoming that star? You have not waited. In time of you to wait, trust me, waiting is not good, because like Saul, you see the soldiers living, you see people running for their dear life. Why? Because they are seeing the problem that you are not seeing. And when they run, when you look at them, you think, no, I am wasting time here. Whereas all you had to do is just to sit down and wait. And understand that I have a greater promise, which is greater than my situation. I cannot afford to lose the promise of the Lord. I cannot afford to go astray from His way. I cannot afford to let go of this opportunity with the Lord. Remember the men who were fishing.
What the Bible says, they toiled all night. And yet, because they loved what they do, they still sat in the boat the whole night, waiting for fishes to come. Why didn't they get in the boat and say, we've been here for 5 hours, let's go home? The Bible says they were there the whole night. They waited with patiently, with diligence, with whole hearts, knowing that there is a promise of fish. We are in the sea. There must be a fish somewhere. They stayed and waited for the fish. The Bible says they waited until Jesus found them in the morning. And when Jesus found them, they were already folding their nets, ready to go home. Why? Because they waited the whole night. Because they did what they did the whole night. Because they stayed in that boat with cold, with winds, with storms blowing left and right. They still stayed in the boat waiting for fishes until Jesus came. How many of us are still waiting in the boat? Even if something is not coming, we still wait and you say, I know my Redeemer lives and I will wait for him. If they had not waited, they couldn't have caught fish. Because the Bible says, when Jesus came, he said, throw a net for a catch. The same spot which had no fishes, the entire night, the Bible says they caught a multitude of fishes that they could not even contain themselves. They caught fishes that they had to call their colleagues and say, come and help us carry the fish. It's the fulfillment of that scripture that your cup will overflow. When you don't wait, you cannot overflow because you are not yet filled. While you are waiting, when he comes and finds you at the point where he's supposed to meet you, Namaganjani, he's supposed to fill you up so that you can overflow for others. Hallelujah. Remember Malachi say, I will pour out for you such a blessing that you won't have room enough to contain it. How come you are a child of God who is only blessed within your territory, only for yourself? You have not waited. How come you are a child of God that you are not overflowing, you are not reaching the desired end because you are not waiting? Remember, the Bible says good things come to those who do what? Come again. Good things come to those what? Who went what? Patiently waiting. Not in a hurry to go anywhere else. I'm waiting for the Lord. Why? Because I know he's my Redeemer. I know that when he comes, my story will change. Look at the man who lied in the pool of Bethesda for 38 good years. 38. He just hoped that one day, I know, it will be my turn to dip into the pool. If it was me and you, 6 months past, at most 10, 12 would have gone and said, it's better I go and die somewhere else. Just like what we have done or what we are doing, we still come to church, but our hearts are somewhere else. That's why we will have people who come from far and come and testify of the grace of God in this place, whereas we are sitting here. Because our hearts have already left this place. We are no longer waiting. How many of us have waited for marriage? People, a person comes here, 6 months, they are married, they are gone. How many of us, you've been promised, you'll be a millionaire, you will be a millionaire, you are even growing gray hair, you will be a millionaire. Somebody just comes, goes for one-on-one, prayed for 2 months, boom, they are here. God has made me a millionaire. I have won contracts upon contracts. What happened to you? People come here from everywhere in the world. I have been this, I have been that. And the man of God said. And the man of God said. And I am now here to testify This is what God has done. It has come to pass. Me and you, we've been here in this ministry since Winnie Mandela, 1999. We are still here. We are no longer in Winnie Mandela. We are in the middle. We are still. Our lives has not changed. Why? Because we have left the place of promise. We have left the place of promise. Imagine if Abraham had now gone out and left Sarah and divorced Sarah because she couldn't have children. Today we wouldn't call him the father of many nations. We wouldn't be called the children of Abraham. Are we not the one who sings and say, Abraham's blessings are mine? We wouldn't be called Abraham. Better still, when Isaac, when people were persecuting him, each time he builds a well, they come and fill it up. If he had given up, will there be a well of Isaac today? No. The Bible says in the very story that the more he dug wells, the more richer he became. How many of us have resigned our workplace that God has promised us just because there is a manager who doesn't like you? How many of us have left our homes because other people don't like you? How many of us have lost things because somebody doesn't like you? Just because you are in a company and the manager is tormenting you, is torturing you, is abusing you, he's sending you left, right, front, and said, you forgot that the promise was you will eventually become the HR of that company. Wangala wena, my resume is good, and you go and apply somewhere else. 10 years down the line, I have been in charis. Barileko na, God will make you an HR. Even now, I am still a clerk. Is it God's fault that you are still a clerk? Where he placed you in Eden, you have left. Today is time to go back to our Eden. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, say, it is time to come back. It is time to come back. Abraham ended up giving birth to Ishmael because Sarah couldn't wait for the promise. And look what God said about Ishmael. He'll be a man of the bush. Today, descendants of Ishmael are in the mountains. But only if they had waited upon the Lord. My question is, what is it that God has promised you when you first received him? What is it that God has promised you? When I heard this message, I asked myself the same question. What is it that God has promised me? Am I within the promise or I've walked away from the promise? Because when things, some of us, when things start to happen that are leading you to the promise, you forget yourself. That Kana, there is a promise I'm going to. Because now I have gotten the job, you forget yourself. And you forget that there is an enemy who's been hunting you season after season, year after year, generation after generation. You forget all of that and you relax. I have reached, I have landed. Nothing will happen to me. There's nothing that they will do to me. And you start slacking in the promise of the Lord and eventually you walk away from the promise. Let's read Isaiah 40. Verse 29 to 30, we all know the scripture. Verse 29 to 31. Can you read in your Bible, Isaiah 40, 29 to 31? Read. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who has no mind, he increases power. Even youth grow weary and tired, and vigorously young men stumble badly. But those who wait for the Lord... Let me read it for you. It says, but those who wait for the Lord
who expect, look for, and hope in him will gain new strength and renew their power. They will lift up their wings and rise up close to God like eagles. Rising towards the sun, they will run and not become weary. They will walk and not grow tired. Why are you tired if you are waiting? There's a line I love here that says, they will, King James Version says, they will mount up with wings like an eagle. They will lift up their wings and rise up close to God like eagles. An eagle is the most powerful bird here on earth. You know why? Because an eagle can fly very high to where the temperature is minus zero with no problem. It can still breathe, it can still function. And the more it goes up, the more its vision is clear. Because it's far, it doesn't mean the view here, down here, it's blur. No. The more it goes up, the more clearer the vision becomes down here. Meaning when an eagle is up there, it can even see the most tiniest stone on the ground. They will mount up with wings like an eagle. They that wait upon the Lord. When you wait upon the Lord, when situation comes, you mount up with your wings like an eagle. AMP says they fly closer to God. Meaning when trials come in your waiting period or season, you must get closer to God. Why? So that your strength can be increased, your vision can become more clearer. You don't allow things that are around you to blur your vision. There's a thing that happens to eagle. There's a bird called a pecker that they say it climbs on the back of an eagle and it starts pecking the eagle at its neck so that the eagle can die and it feast over the eagle. They say when the pecker is busy pecking the eagle doesn't pay attention to the pecker. Instead, it flies high where the temperature is minus zero and the pecker can't breathe when it gets there. Automatically, it falls on its own. Automatically, not with strength. The eagle does not try to fight the pecker so that the pecker can fall down. The eagle does not try to roll its back on the ground so that the pecker... They say the pecker goes, the eagle goes up. And it gets to the point where the pecker can't breathe. Do you know that when you can't breathe, you faint? So meaning the pecker faints and falls on its own to the ground. And now the eagle is left doing what an eagle does best. Soaring high. So why when the pecker climbs on your back, you search for a tree or for the ground to rub the pecker off your back? As you are waiting, when the pecker who is the enemy comes for you, soar up with wings like that of an eagle and be closer to your creator. Why? Because he's the one who renews your strength. Remember the Bible says the name of the Lord is a strong tower and they that run to it are safe. Meaning when you run, when you fly with wings like an eagle, while waiting, you become safe within your space and your territory. Meaning even what the enemy is trying to do, he can't prevail. Why? Because you are closer to the pillar of your strength. You are right in the presence of the pillar of your strength. He's a strong tower. Run to it so you can be safe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Instead of running the opposite direction, instead of moving from point A, point B, looking for prophets, looking for this, looking for that, rather run, fly towards the Lord. Run towards the Lord. Where he's going to keep you safe. Some says it's under the shadow of his wings where you are kept safe. Like a big bear, when you run, God
embraces you and he hides you. So that when a fowl or when a wolf come searching for you to devour, they can't find you, but they find the bear. That's why a bear is called the mama bear. Because you can never find its cub anyway. Why are we not running towards the Lord, running away from the Lord? Waiting is not good, yes. Waiting is painful, yes. Waiting is it makes you to be rejected. It needs you to be rendered useless. You will never amount to anything. The minute you hear those words, run to the strong tower and say, I know with Christ I can do all things. Just run to your tower and say, I know I'm the chief cornerstone of my family. It doesn't matter whether they say I'm useless. It doesn't matter whether they say I'm jobless. It doesn't matter whether they've rejected me and they said nothing good will ever come out of you. As long as I am waiting in the Lord, my promise is greater than the situation I'm facing. Where I'm going is far more important than what the devil is trying to do. Remember, David said, 1,000 will fall on my left, 10,000 on my, but no harm will do what will befall me. The same tower promised you that when they come up to eat your flesh at night, they will flee from you in 7 ways. Why are you not running to the strong tower so you can wait with patience and strength on him? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why are we now living a Christian life that is a normal? We are no longer even touching people we are living with because of the kind of Christianity we are displaying. Nobody wants to be a Christian anymore. Why? Because of the way we are living. We are failing to wait upon the, we are failing to understand, I am a child of promise. I am a child on an assignment. My mission cannot be impossible. My mission has to be possible. Why? Because they are children, they are neighbors, they are family, there is a generation that is waiting for me to pave the way for them. So I have to wait on the Lord, not from the Lord. I have to wait on the Lord. Because those that wait shall renew their strength. There's somebody who sings and say, Ngisize Nkosi ngingasuki endaweni yami yokulinda. Nalapho imimoya ivunguza. Ngisize ngingasuki ethembeni. Why? Ngoba othembisile uyathembeka. Noma kungathembisi, he who has promised is faithful, although it seems unfaithful. Help me to stay and wait in my waiting time. Why? Because I know that you will come for me. David said, I sought the Lord and he answered me. I searched for him, he answered me. I waited. Be a Christian who can be told in history that so and so waited until the Lord showed up for them. So and so stayed in the presence until the Lord came for them. Be that kind of a Christian that people can say in your community, we can see people, yes, but the God of so and so is alive. When they ask, how did you see? They say, we would sin by sisters. Mama, we have been going to church for long, but when God finally turned their cry, it was as if they were children. Hallelujah. Amen. But all of that happens when we are waiting. All of that happens when we are waiting. In the season of waiting, some of us, we went and got ourselves husbands and wives that we shouldn't have. Some of us, we have entered into business deals that are requiring our lives today. We are learning, we are living, hiding from this house to the next. Why? Because there are people who want to kill you because you are in the wrong kind of business. Because you failed to wait. on the Lord. Hallelujah. Ask your neighbor and say, are you still waiting? Psalms 37, verse 7 and verse 34. Can I read? Psalm 37, verse 7, it says, be still before the Lord. Wait patiently for him and entrust yourself to him. Underline the words, entrust yourself to him. Do not fret, meaning whine, agonize, because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who carries out wicked schemes. Do not fret or agonize. How many of us are agonizing? To agonize is to complain, to nag. To agonize is to speak negatively towards the promise that God has given you. To agonize is to say things that are contrary to the promise that you have. In other words, is to complain. There's a language we love saying in Venda. All of us, we say it in our native dialect, that zwanga zwingi zwabangwa wa konyaka zwichifana na zwanyi ngauri bone bubumbi wa be bothe baba konyaka zwichifana na zwanyi ngori mudzima chivavidza ovavidza be bothe mudzima chivafurufedzisa vova be bothe achivachidza vova be bothe. When God gave you that promise, you were alone. When God told you where he's taking you, you were alone. You were created uniquely according to your pattern, alone. Hence, there's nobody who is like you. Even if you are a twin, you are identical outside, but your characters are not the same. Because you are designed alone, in his image, alone. That's agonizing. That's complaining. That's whining. You know what whining is? Whining is when your child, if you have a young child, you have a toddler, right? You see, when your child keeps coming and saying, mommy, 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 mommy. When you answer out of character, isn't it? Because you're already annoyed, they are calling you over and over and over, and they are not saying what their problem is. Isn't it? The way you're going to answer is not going to be nice. That's what whining is. That's what you are doing to God. Me, my job, my job, my job, my job, my job, my job, my job. Well, I feel like all the ladies that you are not supposed to do because you are whining. How many of us, our prayers have turned into whining? You don't have to tell the next person. Tell yourself. How many of us, our prayers have turned into whining? Our prayers have become those kind of prayers. Say, ah, God, even if it's just corrupting, it's fine. Even if it's utoshera muta zoruga, na kwande kwa gerama hati zoruga. Even if it's just making tea, it's fine. After God gave your parents all their strength. I was telling my daughter when she said she wants to be a primary teacher, I said, after all the school fees we are paying, if you're a teacher, don't get me, there's nothing wrong with teaching. It's just that according to me, the amount of school fees I'm paying and teaching, you must become something I can't pronounce. According to me, I'm not saying it's wrong, according to me. If your child wants to be a teacher, we need teachers, don't we? Don't we need teachers? Thank you. But me, personally, my dear, the amount of money I'm paying for school fees, you can't be a teacher. You must be one thing I can't pronounce when I'm asked, what is it that your child is? As my dear, they say, it's something that has to do with the stars. Anamu we. Or did you ask him to teach? Dina lady anamu wo. Anamu we masuike. Ngorvare adi angi inketse ingenya kolo otseba mutwak. Karo kito YouTube. Anamu we. After all God has done for you, you come and belittle his promise by one tiny
whining statement. After he died on the cross, blood gushed, even water came out of him. You want to come and stand and pronounce a statement that says, Modimo wa kgetha, how? When you're only failing to wait. Life in the spiritual realm is practical to life in the physical realm. See how you give birth to a child and they grow up, you take them to the school, they go primary, secondary, tertiary, they search for a job, they graduate, they have a diploma, and you put a photo there on the wall and say they have graduated. You don't know whether they have diploma or degree. Who graduate looks like Shulemul. The same applies with the spiritual world. God gives birth to you. You grow, he grooms you, he grooms you. At some point, you must manifest. That's why there's a scripture that says, the world is eagerly waiting for the manifestation of the sons and daughters of God. Who are the sons and daughters? It's you and me. So by us not waiting, we are not only risking ourselves, we are also risking the world at large. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 7 says, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him and entrust yourself in him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his ways, because of a man who carries out wicked schemes. Read 34 as well. Let's read 34 of the same chapter. It says, wait for and expect the Lord and keep his way. It means while I'm waiting, I'm doing what he wants me to do, wholeheartedly expecting his way. And he will exalt you to inherit the land. In the end, when the wicked are cut off, you will see it. And he will exalt you to inherit the land. Remember that scripture that God told Joseph that everywhere you set your foot, I have given you. That's inheritance. So if you cannot wait, you can't have inheritance. I don't know if you understand me. If you can't wait, he cannot exalt you to inherit. And while you are waiting, you expect him to come through. That's why the Bible says, he who has promised will surely show up for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And while you expect him, you keep his way. The way of serving wholeheartedly with patience. You see how you become pregnant and you expect a baby. With that excitement, you can't wait for the last day. Finally, they say your baby is here. You even do shopping before. Am I right? You go shopping before the baby comes. You have already bought all colors, all outfits. This one is for Sunday, for a wedding, for what, for what, for what, for what. You are waiting with expectation. Doing the rightful way. Taking your meds, your multivitamin, your iron, your what. Why? Because you are waiting for the precious gift. The same thing we have to do in the Lord. While I wait, I am waiting in his word. I'm telling myself, those that wait upon the Lord, he shall renew their strength. I shall mount up with wings like an eagle. Way closer to God. When the devil comes and say, you have been waiting, madam, your mates are out there hustling. Abi, you are sitting here saying, Jesus, Jesus, where is your Jesus? You tell yourself, I am not called to be a hustler. I am a child of God, born and bred by the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, I am a chosen generation, a peculiar person, a holy priesthood, chosen for nations. I cannot risk my blessing for what is in front of me. While waiting on the Lord, I want us to go, I want us to put ourselves in all these people I've mentioned today, from Saul to Abraham to David to everybody, to the disciples. Had they not waited in Jerusalem, we wouldn't have the Holy Spirit today.
Had Saul had waited a few more minutes for Samuel, he would have inherited Israel.
Today we don't speak of Saul, we speak of David. David, he even wrote the book of Psalms to give praises because his reign was great.
His reign was great. Even his children fought for his throne because his reign was great. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says Abraham staggered not at the promises of the Lord. It means he didn't move an inch. He didn't even move his soul like this at the promise that you will have a son and you will be the father of nations. Today we call ourselves the children of Abraham. Why? Because he staggered not at the promise of the Lord while waiting for a child for 100 years. But he waited for the promise. Hallelujah.